Test. Super. Dobar dan svima. Welcome everyone. I'll switch to English because we're going to keep the event in English. My name is Stani Minikov. I'm the manager of EPAM Systems in Bulgaria. Why is EPAM Systems standing here opening an event? I joined EPAM about 3 years ago, and one of the first things I did is I attended a conference in Sofia. It was very interesting. It was about Java. I know I'm in the wrong room, but it was about Java. I kind of thought that it could be a bit more focused on technology. It could be a bit more focused on technical rather than commercial stuff, and that's how we initiated Tech Talks. Tech Talks is the event where developers and IT experts should exchange information. It's for the first time outside Serbia, thanks to the Bulgarian municipality with their help, and with the help of a lot of other people. For the first time, we are able to present this in Burgas, which I think is a great venue. It should be a lot of fun. And it's always a good feeling to be between the first speaker, which you are waiting for, and the start of the event. So I would like to welcome Martin. Martin is from SBTech, one of the best speakers I know. So welcome, and I hope you guys enjoy the event.
My name is Miranda Shonova. I'm a resource manager at EPAM Systems, and I want to present today the first speaker at JavaStream, and this is Martin Knobloch. This is actually his second time speaking at Tech Talks. He was here in the early summer speaking about OWASP, Secure OWASP, and by then he generated such a big interest from the Tech Talks community that we decided to invite him for a second time, and he accepted. We're very happy about that. Today he'll be speaking about hackers' mindset, and I really hope you enjoy this presentation. So listen and enjoy.
Change of the microphone. Okay. Hi there. My name is Martin Knobloch, as you said. I myself was a developer. And when I went to development, I was really scared about security because I come actually from the industrial side of software development. Because before I was a developer, I was a mechanical injection molding. And my first thing I did, my first code review, I didn't know what code review is, was finding a bug in a PLC programming system. And that's a physical world, so when something goes wrong in the physical world, you have a very physical feedback. Something crashed, and something crashed, and it's impressive. So I went into software development and was wondering about security there. And then I had to make a split between software development and security. I made a jump to security, but it's still my heart is developers. So who of you is a developer? Are you not proud to be a developer? We are all developers. Hey, we are developers. Everything on the world runs on your software. And who of you ever thought about software security? Hey, four. How comes? What the rest do? Functionality. And actually, it's a problem when you look in the security community because they're always blaming your developers doing everything wrong. And it's also, who has ever had lessons when they studied IT in security? Who did a university study? I didn't. Who have heard about security? What do you learn about network security, critical free, isn't it? But it's something you use, not something you have to do yourself. But, so I want to show you a bit the mindset of a hacker. What a hacker tries to achieve, you know, you have to see in consideration. So hopefully, next time, tomorrow, maybe later today, you sit behind the keyboard and type code, you look at your code and your functionality differently. I show this because we have seen the Matrix. You know how old the movie is? It's 1996. Isn't that scary? Makes you feel old. So this is because we all write software. We don't write manuals anymore, isn't it? It's all intuitive. And I want to show you the different approach, the different how a hacker will see software. Because it's not about breaking stuff, it's about seeing functionality and using it for my own purpose. Because when I break an application, I cannot abuse it anymore. So I don't want to give you the choice for the right job. And please, hacking is a crime. Be careful. I don't show you any tricks, so, but whatever you test, keep in mind that it is, when you do it for a productive system, you don't have the right permissions, it's illegal. So I want to give you a handhold information, so next time you can maybe dodge the bullet and don't get hit by an easy attack. And it's not always as obvious. Software security, it's the mindset is not as obvious. It's not like, hey, look, here's the SQL injection file, or here's the evil SQL or the evil server file. But it's really simple the moment you see the right signs. So what is a hacker? A lot of people imagine hacker, they're really cool, isn't it? They're sitting in the penthouse suite in a hotel, hacking away, being the cool guys, drinking wine, writing viruses, six screens simultaneously, is that cool? Who thinks that it's the life of a hacker? No way, unfortunately. Most of the time, we have to actually think what is the background of a hacker. Whom do we want to protect against? And the basic thing is a script kiddie. Those are hackers have time in the hand, you know, default nerds sitting at home, their parents' attic or basement, eating pizza, having no visual friends, only virtual. They have time, but have no money. The next one is the organized crime, and that's the one we have to focus on. They have time and money, and they are skilled. And the last, the highest level is state and government. And to be honest, who can protect you against the government? Nobody. So we have to at least pretend and automate against script kiddies. And if you have sensitive data and transactions, that are important business transactions, we have to be protected against the organized crime. It's the next step to protection. But hackers are criminals and have a gain, and they have something why they're doing it. And of course, the motivation, all the it says from there, but when it's an activist, they want to have the fame. Yeah, that's creepy. But hacker, organized crime, they have to think about the return of investment. Because it's a company, and they have to make money. And they make victims. And the victims are your code. The application is you write. So what's the treasure the hackers are up to? What is it that they want to achieve? Because I hear many times, we have only 100 users. Or we have no sensitive data. Or I have nothing to hide. All this kind of stuff. So what is the hacker wants to get? And the hacker wants to get, the first thing is IDs, identities. And then we all think about the web, identity theft, isn't it? Ooh, they can abuse my identity. So is there a second party cloak suddenly running around? What they want to do is have address, post address, and information enough to do stuff. What can they do? Everything you do in the criminal world, in the digital world, will stay in the digital world. So it's very funny to have digital money somewhere, billions. But it does not make my physical life better. So I need a proxy how to transfer the value in the digital world to the value in the physical world. And that's where the ideas are in some form. Because think about yourself, who has ever booked a hotel online or ordered something online? What I need is a name and address. And that's what I get here. Maybe I can ask for social insurance money using your address. You will not feel it until somebody thinks, hey, that's fraud. And they show up for you because it's your name and address used and not a hacker's one. So ideas. And of course there is countermeasures like detection. how to detect that something goes wrong. I see many companies say, we are never hacked. I say, how can you tell? I said, we have nothing in our log files. And I always think about Independence Day, when you upload a virus, you know, in the alien mothership, you see this skull and bones. That's not what the hacker leaves. The hacker tries to leave no evidence back. So they don't want to be detected. They don't want to break stuff. So they're using abusing the functionality you write. And we have the right protection to get in there. For example, when I do a financial transaction, there are steps I have to take to get there. It's not that I suddenly transfer 10,000 euros. So an attack, to think about them, is what we call an attack tree. An attack tree you can do. So you look at your functionality, you look at your software and say, hey, how can I abuse it? So you think about bad cases. For example, it's easier. Think about the physical world. There is somewhere is a safe. And I want to open the safe. How can we do that? What would be ways to open a safe? Anyone? Idea? Sorry?
Know the code.
Yeah. I start with a bad guy first. They pick the lock. It's not that hard that you think, actually, when you do lock picking. You can get a combination, yes. If you know the combination, it opens up. I can cut it open. Physical label, we don't like that. Or we can install it improperly. So maybe when we are in the process of installing the safe, we can make faults. Of course, then you have to be very early. Lock picking, you need a skill. So let's look into how to get a combination. What do you think? How can we get a combination?
Social engineering.
Yes, it's one thing to find some written thing, find something written down, or indeed get a combination from a target, trick him to give it to me. So always look at the easiest part. So how to get a combination from a target is like eavesdrops. Social engineering, try to get it to me, blackmailing him. That's always so. And then the last one, the rubber hose attack. You heard about that? You take a rubber hose and you beat him until he gets his combination. So that's how you can define how something can gain from your application. You write down the worst case scenario and think about the possibilities. And actually, these days, there are gamification of doing this. When I discussed that in a board meeting, it was really terrible. So there are gamification like the Microsoft Threat Model game of the OS Polypopia. When you play about it and think about it, and you are away from your laptop, away from your keyboard, and have a different mindset, and think about possibilities, how to abuse your application. What's very important is the application breakdown. And the best thing is to think about your application like a physical building. In every physical building, there are areas, like a public somewhere, everybody's allowed to. We have the restricted zone, only a few people are there. And there's some somewhere nobody's allowed only security. Yeah? The same is for your application. And what you need to know is who is walking around my application? What is my evidence, my detection? Who is logged in, what he is doing, where the breadcrumbs? And then you want to see, hey, where's the security editor? Where do I have to have authentication? And for authentication, you get authorization, who has access to it? By breaking down your application, then the next thing is to find the shortcuts. Where can I jump? Where can I escalate my privileges? Where can I change the context of application so that I have the possibilities I had not had before? It's all very complicated, but actually going down, breakdown, security is 70% input validation and output handling. It's 70%. Knowing where is my application input, how it gets in, and how to which target I send it out. And then of course there's a business logic, how our data flow, our process flow goes to the application. That's the things that hackers are interested in. And how do I get the information? Imagine that it's my bank dot Bulgaria, and I want to attack them. How can I know about their processes? How can I know about the, how they work? How can I get information about the system? If I want to know which technology you're using, I just have to look at the job boards. Or at sites like LinkedIn. If I see somebody works at mybank.bg and he's a Java developer, they might use Java. And if they look for a web server administrator, hey, it might be the server. So all the information is out there. Unfortunately, a lot of companies are fixated on having a black box test. Have you heard that? Whoever had a security test against the application? You had a black box test? So that's really great. So we have the developers here, they're writing the code, and there comes the super smart hero hacker. He doesn't talk to the developers, does he? He does his security matching for 5 days, time boxed. And what do you get? A PDF. But you don't know what he reached, you don't know what he did, you don't just say what he found. A black box test only shows you how bad your application is, not how good it is. So what you need to know is going through the processes I can use. And what's another thing a lot of people forget? Timing. Information can be very relevant depending on the time. But also when the functionality is open, how long is it open? Your session management, for example, default web session management, web session, how long is it valid? Default? Who knows that? Who does web application development? Nobody? No web developer, you don't dare. That's, default is 30 minutes. That means if your session top is valid for 30 minutes, I have an attack phase for 30 minutes to attack the session. But wait a minute. But it's mostly unlimited as long as you keep sending requests. Doesn't sound secure. It's like my phone number, and I can put a key in, it's open forever until I close it. Who does that at home? Replay. Try for your own application if you have a request sent. And I can send it again. It's exactly identical same request. Will it be detected? A normal user never will send the same request twice. The identical request. But that thing's I try for. When is there an application, I record my session, and if there's a transaction, I look at it if I can resend it. Can I twice and three times? And so there's a lot of functionality, it's really good for me as a hacker. Like one functionality everybody tries to write, everybody has Spring, these days we use frameworks for everything, is file upload. Whoever wrote a file upload functionality or implemented it in his application? So, file upload. What you do is a file. So there's this nice icon, you push it, you select a file, you say upload, and then what? It comes to your server. What is the first thing you do? What you should do is character unit. It's something coming from the outside. And everything that comes from the outside, we do not trust. It's not from me. So character unit, write it away to a file system location where there's no execute write, where it cannot interfere with the application server or the server. So we have to take the file, we put it in character unit, and then we do what? We check for virus. And there's an example virus file for that already. So you can have the example file uploaded to your virus scan. And if there's no alerting, your file scan is broken. The first thing you can do, take the file and upload it. But also the file size is dependent. A lot of times I do a security test, I say, don't do DDoS. What is DDoS? Distributed denial of service. Say, hey, distributed, I don't have network left, but I don't do a DDoS attack, distributed denial of service. Because it means that I make so many connections until the server just collapses and cannot take it anymore. And that's not functionality, it's not software, it's networking. It's for the other guys, it's for the operation system there in the basement. We don't care about them now. So look at the file size. But I say, what is the functional DOS attacks? What is it if I can upload hundreds of files with gigabytes? What will happen to your server? Oh, bad. So there should be a catch. There's also something very important. It's the design principles. Security design principles, there are several principles. One very part of that is fail securely. So when you have too many files written up, there's no file system left. Don't crash, because your file system should detect that it's running out of error and then just say, hey, this service library not available. So we have a file, we fill the data size, it cannot be too much, we have to quarantine it, we have to hear the file scan it, and then the next thing, besides, what's that? It's the format. There is a reason why the file is uploaded. It's a picture file that we can validate if it's really a picture. If it's an XML file, we have to validate is the XML file the file we had expected. How do we validate XML files? Schema, I guess. We're strict. You see here, like, my 5.1, max occurrence unbounds. Hey, cool. Let's see how it really reacts if it's close to unlimited. What is the typecasting so important? How's the length? Max occurrence, min occurrence, and external entities. Have you heard about those? What is an external entity in XML? I can put everything in there. That's really, really great. They added this functionality because they said, maybe ever once might be useful. I know nobody ever needed it. But you have to switch it off by hand, because by default it's enabled. That's security. So you validate it. Yes, we use a schema and we switch off external entities, because those are evils. We don't know what they do. And they can browse the file system and can return files as you command. But this is more abstract. Whoever bought anything online. And when you go to the web shop, you are allowed to look, browse the products and add them in your basket, isn't it? You have to be authenticated for that? Like we have to log in?
No.
Why not? There are two reasons for that. A, for every border I put in, people leave. Hey, why should I log in here? The other one does it for free. And also the physics, the mentality is the moment I put stuff in my shopping basket, people think it's theirs already. It's not, but they say so. When you go shopping in a physical market, you ever had it? You want to buy something and you see that a guy in front of you just grabs the last one? So what do you do? Disappointed, walk on. You can see if his shopping basket is not unintended and take it out of his shopping cart. You ever tried this? I did. You know, what do you think what they say? Hey, that's mine. I say, no, it's not. You haven't bought it yet. When you're 6'4" and long hair, it's quite funny. Don't try it at home. So, that's why I do it. Because people will think when it's my shopping cart, they already own it. I just have to pay. But then, maybe I'm undecided, I haven't bought it yet. So I close the browser, go home to something else, come back to log in, go to the website, and my shopping cart is still there. How does it come? How can the browser know what I did last time? Any ideas?
Cookies!
What is a cookie? It's a property file, it's a key value pair file. And actually, apparently, there is an ID. And this ID tells the server, he has been here before. Yes, in the internet, you all numbers. So what happens if I can't change the cookie number? Maybe I can see somebody else's shopping cart. So if mine is empty, and I want to buy this one product, there's no one in stock, but I can find somebody else's shopping cart, and here's this last item, maybe I can just say, okay, he doesn't want it yet. It's very hard, and luckily the frameworks are better and better to make this shopping cart ID less predictable. But unfortunately, many times I see people write it themselves, and I have shopping cart ID of 100. What can I expect? There are 99 others. So don't be predictable. Whoever bought something on eBay, then you want to buy something. For example, this laptop, say, I want to sell it, I'm done with it. And I say, hey, he say, okay, I pay 50 euros. Then you come up and say, okay, I bid 55. What can he see from you? He sees a part of the username. Why is that? In the beginning of eBay, I could see the complete username. Why would I do that? Of course, when I'm bidding is all about not buying the stuff for the best price. It's like you want to get people into a bidding fight. So when he sees that he bids 55, what is he doing? He's going 60 and he knows his name now. And what is he doing? What is your name? Ivan. Ivan. 65. And your name is? Sorry? What do you think then? Yes. What do you do then? No, you're not bidding over it. That would be the nice way to do it. What happens if I lock in incorrectly 3 times? You lock out. You think, hey, his username is this 123. I don't need his password. I don't want his password. I want him not be able to bid over me. So I lock him out by using his username and wrong password 3 times. And then you go over his bid. What are you thinking? What happened? That's how an attacker uses functionality to his own advantage. It's not possible anymore. That's why I can say it. That's why you now only see a part of the other username. So you cannot guess it, they say. Identification is really hard. How do I know that somebody, Ivan, did a spit? How do I know that? All I did, he put in a registration, he filled in the username password, and we got an account, isn't it? And on the web, it's quite easy because we have a physical desktop, there's an explorer, but everything that happens on my business logic. Ever heard about a baby duck? What is very typical on a baby duck? Whoever has seen a baby duck in real life?
Follows the duck.
Yes. So when you are here, the moment it comes out of the egg, who is his mother? The first person sees you. When you're here, it's like, mommy. And this is what we have now with the IoT, with the device we can buy, with our Fitbit watches, our iPhone, Samsung, I don't want to know, everybody, but any IoT device, the moment I can reset it, it's like a baby duck. Hey, my owner, be your humble slave. What do you do then? Can we protect the device against being rebooted? There are some possibilities, but they're much too complicated, so we don't do that. Is that hard? So this is a different new problem when you write software for IoT. But luckily, we require a username and password, isn't it? So, whom of you ever filled in those two fields? Anyone? Yeah. I know a friend of mine, he's from a bank. And they record the IP address, the timestamp, and the username. But they can retrieve the password, or can link the password to the username, more than 2,000 times a month. How is that possible? They don't log it, but in their log files they can correlate username and password. How can that be possible? You never had it that the site is building up and you're putting in username, tab, password, but you mistype the tab and you write username and password together and then enter. No, never happened. Or you put username, tab, password, but then the site refreshes and you type the password in the username field. Yes, and the username field context will be right in the log files. So how much protection, how much security do we have for accessing those log files? because if I had access, apparently this one situation, but it's not very typical for them, I have 2,000 a month using passwords on my banking website. Hey, think about it. So, if this is misspelled, if I have the wrong username or wrong password, what then? You ever wrote the login functionality? Anyone? Sorry? Yeah, but no, you accidentally mistype it. So, when I mistype the username field, what does the website tell me? Incorrect username and password. Oh, no, the username was wrong. Why don't say, hey, guy, this user doesn't exist? Why don't I do that?
Because you won't be able to get that username.
Yes, and I would know who the users are. So as hacker, if I want to know all the usernames, what did I do? On the registration page.
Try them all.
Yeah, but if you don't have a feedback, if the feedback is same, you don't know which one it is. But then I do the registration field. Maybe you know from Facebook. So I put in Martin Knobloch and they say, oh, okay, the Martin username is already taken, you can win Martin 135,000. So I know, okay, this one exists. Next one. We can automate this. So we don't use the username password field to find the usernames, we use the registration field. Ah. Same for password. So when now imagine you wrote a functionality. You get a username and password string to your server. What is the first thing you do in your functionality you write?
Validate.
Sorry?
Validate
what?
The username and the password.
Yeah, but the process. So you get a username string and a password string.
Most of the time the password string is encrypted.
By whom?
By us.
Then you get it from the browser?
No.
So you get two strings.
We encode it and we check that in the database does the password and the username match.
Okay. So what the most people write first is okay, the username, I validate if there is a user with this username, isn't it? The first thing. Yeah? So, get password by username, for example. And if I don't get a password back, what's that?
There is no user.
So we don't have to check the password?
Yes.
Is that true? So imagine username does exist, so we get a password hash. What we do then? You hash the password you got, and then you match it.
Yes.
Hashing, it's a time-consuming functionality. So there's a difference in timing. If the password is incorrect, and the username is incorrect, I get a quicker response, apparently, than when the password is incorrect. Okay, so when the username is incorrect, it says, oh, the user does not exist. And if the password is correct or incorrect, I have to fit that the password is correct. So it's a timing attack. Have you heard about Madison Ashley problem? That's exactly what happened. Timing attack. You always have to validate the password. That sounds really weird, but then you have no timing attack possibility anymore. So you get username from the field. If that user does not exist, you hash the password anyway. It's the timing you need to hash it. It's delay. And of course, the comparison between two strings, that's not measurable time. So then you send it back. But always do the functionality that the timing comes. That's very funny. There's so much more technology these days to have the indirect information gathering. So it's not about what happens, it's about the feedback that gives the site to me. And then, of course, we have the password for Google Link. Who ever clicked that? What do you expect when you click on it?
On the mail.
Sorry?
On the mail.
On the mail. What do you get in the mail?
You get a link or a call.
Yeah. In the past, and unfortunately it still happens, they say, oh, this is using the password. Or it's better if, of course, send an email. Your email will be sent to this email, your password will be sent to this email address. one. And I changed it once. And apparently, they used it when I said yes, they used the password in the text field of this form. So I had one email address. I think the password forgotten from a username. It said, your password will be sent to this email address. I changed the email address and said, okay, go. And he said, my clear text password to another email. That's not good. So I told them, hey, you shouldn't do that. But hey, it was a right click protection. I couldn't right click on the page source. What does this say? How do I protect that I can't click the right button, mouse button on the web page? Then there's some JavaScript security. Sorry? Yes, of course, on the front end. When I intercept a request or a response, I can see anyway, and then the browser shows me anyway. View source code. Very easy, F9, I thought. So I sent them an email saying, hey guys, that's not good. A, please don't store my clear text password. And B, you should not send it to a random email being put into. Because when they have a username from me anyway, you should know my email address I put in on registration. Just say, and most websites do this day, your password reset link will be sent to your email address. By the way, the one I did, I told them that they're not doing it right. Were they happy? Hey, it was free of guys. You think yes? I said, no. You looked at my source code. It's forbidden. So I looked like, oh, okay. So I sent them an email telling them about HTML, how does it work, and the link is HTML for dummies. I tried to educate. And I get an email back from, we will do, if you do that again, we will sue you to end of ages. Yeah, they didn't learn. So what you want is an email where I have a link. In the link, I have a very long random number, my password reset token. And then what? So this is a token. When I click on it, I go to a page that says, okay, put in your old password or put in a new password or some security questions. What is a very good security question?
What's your father's name?
What is the name? Is this a very security question? No. Everybody knows what's your mother's maiden name. What's your mother's maiden name? No, everybody knows. It's not a secret. So we don't do secure questions anymore because there are no secure questions. You end up putting out fake answers and then you have to recall which fake answer you have done in your school anyway. The same for password rules, isn't it? It has to be passwords. How long have they been to be? Sorry? Yeah, there will be most websites say 8 characters. Someone once said, and this comes from a time we moved from mainframes, like 4 characters, he said, well, let's be more secure. Let's do 8. And then what else we have as password restrictions? Yes, we have to have capital letter, lowercase letter, and special characters. That makes it easier to remember? No. But it was easier to brute force. Because I know it has to be at least 8 characters long, so I can forget all possibilities for 7 characters. So I need 8. So at the moment I have a capital A, the chance that second capital cannot be 7 other capital A's. Because we also have the figure and special characters, can only be 6 hours. So you can actually, you limitate the possibilities. So what you want to have are long password fields, like password phrases. That's the way how you do it. Interesting. So, but of course, so this one. Ever had this? What is this?
SQL injection,
yes. What does it mean? It means that my request here, whatever, but I fill in here, or 1 equals 1, so what is valid. Why I put a second colon behind it? Terminate it, and this is?
Comment.
Yeah. What does comment mean? This is? Yeah, but it's line comment. So if it's a multi-line query, only this one line will be, the rest of the line will be ignored. What's also very funny, that's where you need to know the knowledge, and that's why the hackers are super smart, because they have to need no wrong. When I have, do I need to have a space in between there? Between the semicolon and the comma type? Who uses MySQL? Then you need it. Because it's written together, you will not recognize this as a comma type.
Yep.
Also, fuck, nice difference. And it's like, oh yeah, we don't need it in our password field. Ooh, scary. But imagine if this is an update field. Update every record. Update every record. Actually, a friend of mine had some kind of problem with that. They had a field, a date field. It was year minus month minus day. And somebody did a typo. Did year minus minus month minus day. And they updated all the records for the whole year. It was only September. But the backup didn't work for the last 2 years. Oops. So you also have to protect against errors by the user. But then, we use frameworks these days, isn't it? We don't write our own SQL anymore, do you?
No.
Sorry?
We do.
Yeah, you do, of course. It's much more secure. What is the prevention against this?
Sanitizing
what? Yes, and how do you sanitize SQL input?
Remove some special
type. Wrong. Blacklisting. How do a database wants you to talk with it? It's prepared statements with parameter parization. And this not parameter binding. And these days we have name binding. You know, in the past we have question marks. Then we have to count how many question marks we had, and we have to fill it in. These days we have name binding. Perfect. And actually, we have frameworks for this. Object, relation, object mapping, ORM frameworks. Object relation mapping. Like Hibernate, for example. Who else is there? You don't like it. Hibernate by itself is really good because they do security and they do not parameter binding. It's also good. Yeah. They do also parameter binding underwater. And Hibernate was the one biggest and best, but then the developer said, yes, but we want need flexibility. So we have dynamic Hibernate query language. SQL injection introduced again. But there's another problem. When you get an object, and you want to put in another object, how you do the object binding? Do you ever did object binding? So for example, you get from one time when I log in, I get a username, password, maybe address, I don't care. And on the server side, the object itself contains another field, contains role. So what if I inject into the request a role field? If there's not explicit binding, when I say, okay, this username must be this username, and password, and I don't care about the rest, but I just clone the object, so this object is this object, and I add the role field, this will also be updated. That's what the object relation manager does for you. This was a problem in GitHub. You can just could add the role ID, and you got a role. The guy said, hey, what's the ID for administrator? Oh, must be the one. Role ID is one. Added to the request, and he was not made. So explicit binding is very important, not just taking the object from it comes from the internet, we must trust it. No, never trust. So make an object, look in the values, and do explicit binding that nothing else has been added to it. That's a general problem. I don't have no idea how we do it on time. Okay. There's a general problem. Broken connections. It's not all connected. Who does online banking? Who does mobile banking? What is more secure? Who thinks mobile banking is more secure than online banking? Nobody. Who thinks online banking is more secure than mobile banking? the rest things, these scruples, actually, if done right, mobile banking is more secure than online banking because of the attack factor. When I want to attack online banking, I have to attack the browser. And everybody uses the same browser, isn't it? What was it last time? 95% use Microsoft still? But when I want to attack mobile banking, I have to attack what? A single device, because how many people use mobile, the different versions for different operating system? So by the time I have done my downloaded the installation file, APK or solution, I have to decompile it, investigate it, break it, and then I have to make people to upload it and install it. They already brought out a newer version, and you have to do it again. But the enabling of the online mobile banking account on the phone, it's a non-IT process, not completely. That's where we have a lot of fraud. Another example. What is a Bulgarian holiday, a public holiday, where everybody goes to Burgos? Is it not 8 day everybody wants to be here? National Celebration Day? Oh, summer is a long period. But for example, if I want to book a hotel here in winter, the most likely will be less expensive than the summer, isn't it? So, example, I book a 2 week hotel for November. And I pay. And then I call the hotel. I give me time and say, oh, sorry, I need an error. Your computers are very complicated. Of course, I don't want to be here in winter. I want to be here in August. What will they do on the other side of the hotel? So, no problem. Yes, we have a room available. Your booking has been changed. You think so? Who thinks that works? I know it works. Accidentally, it happened to me. Is it illegal to do so? No. No. Use the first aid facilities. Is connection between the real world and digital world. Connection to, because they can see only you have paid. The hardware can see how much you have paid, and they cannot predict what the price will be if I would have booked for another day. On an airline, a friend of mine changed the seat number. So apparently it was front-end validation. So you know when you check in online, you see all the available seats. And he said, oh, there is one seat, I really want to have that, but it was taken. Let's say seat 3C. So he had to book seat number 29D or something like that. But he saw that he could change the request. So the moment he said, okay, he intercepted the request and changed from 29D to 3C. And there was no server-side validation. So when he went to the airport, had to be early or late? So who thinks he has to be early to get a seat? Where are you thinking? Who thinks he has to be late? Why should he be late and then what?
Because he shows his ticket and says this is my seat. Yeah.
Then
upgrade him to business class.
Yes! Because someone's on there, oh sorry sir, please follow me up to the business class. But you, of course, must be lucky there's a seat available there. The question is, I don't tell you, does the cabin crew know that you are registered? Depends on the airline and on the flight. The bigger and more expensive it is, the more likely they will. Because when you go like to America first class, they really know which name is where, because they value come you by name. I know the second hand, I never come across, but I cannot afford it, unfortunately. But, so with other tickets, you might change only the ticket number. They sure, because they cannot read the barcode. So in the front desk, they read the barcode, when you dare to see it. So what would be a problem to have to alter it? So saying nicely is heat 29D, and you just use paint, whatever, make a 3C from it. Who will notice that you fraud it? I'm not saying you use it. That is fraud, actually. That is not legal. Call it in for saying, sorry, I made a mistake, and you rebook it, it's legal. That's fraud to force it. Don't do that. No forgery. Yeah? There is always a problem, I told you, to get the money. There's a point when all the digital value has become real value, and that is where the most hacker get detected. And of course, as every criminal, they get lazy, they never have enough, and they make fraud. But when they get to the physical world, they have physical feedback. What's the wrong with this one I needed? They get physical feedback. So if I have, for example, hundreds of thousands of digital euros, leather, how do I make it real money? How can I use this digital money? How would this digital money become real money? How do I do that?
Buy goods, for example.
That's one, buy goods, but then don't use your home address because then you get detected. That's why I need the six identities. So, where, no, so, yes, and your surname is? And you work, and where do you live? I should ask you at the beginning of the talk, isn't it? So that's when I know to whom to deliver and just make sure he's not there, and then I can maybe grab it from the postman. Yeah? But that's for goods. I don't want to send a parcel. But I don't want to, I want the one I need to eat. I have to go out. I cannot buy a vacuum cleaner, go to disco and say, do me 3 beer, please. Here's very nice new Dyson vacuum cleaner. Doesn't work. So I need money. How do I get the money? What I use is a mule. It's not a real mule, like for animals, 4 legs. They call a mule. So I need somebody who is untrustable because he wants to help me to take a form. But he has to be reliable because he has to stick to my scheme. Because you can use, what they found out, it takes about 2 years to find a mule. And you only can use it once. And from every mule you find, you can only use about 20%. So a lot of effort is not in hacking, and a lot of effort is in finding mules. They are willing to do a crime, but are still trustworthy because they have to be on a precise time limit, a precise day, on getting the credit card in there and take the money out of that card. It's very hard to find people who are a fraudulent and too trustworthy. That's very hard. And that is where most people get in cybercrime. Any questions? Yeah. Yeah?
What is your mother's maiden name and your trade?
That's quite funny, because when I write to Ripsa for the US, I have to tell them where my mother is born. And I have no clue. So, yeah, it's funny. What can you do with information? This is password reset security questions. I don't know if you know, there's this example of Paris Hilton. You all know who Paris Hilton is. I didn't know it until I heard the story. So back then, we had no smartphones. Can you imagine? We have these mobile devices we could call. That's it. And when you lost your smartphone and lost your SIM card, your contact details were gone. And there was one website that said, if you upload your information to us, they will protect it. A big American ISP. So somebody said, hey, he's so big, maybe Paris Hilton is one of the users, and he put in Paris Hilton as username, and password, I didn't know, so did the password for Cottonfield. And one of the questions, 3 questions was, what is your favorite pet? Who knows the pet of Paris Hilton? You know the name? I really bet his names, but since one guy in one class I gave said Tinkerbell, I cannot forget it anymore. So he put in Tinkerbell and got all the password fields. And then, of course, it happened again. There was Sarah Belling, also big news. Two-factor authentication. It's a very interesting one. It's a very hot one. Yes, I am in favor, but the question is when? What for? It's always a question. I have a laptop, my other laptop, I have username, password fields, or I have fingerprint. Why can I not choose to have either one or both? Who has an iPhone with fingerprint? Where do you use fingerprint for? Can you choose?
I'm not sure, but unlocking the device.
Yeah, unlocking the device.
Mobile.
Sorry?
Mobile market, yeah.
Yeah.
For the mobile market.
But why can I not say, hey, if I want to log into Facebook, I want to pin my fingerprint, but when I want to log in on my mobile banking, I need a fingerprint and my password, because then I have more authentication. Problem is, in the past, when we have the SMS token, we had separate devices, like on banks, when we have the bank token for our payment to proceed. So we are online, putting our transaction in there, and then we get what they call separation of channels, we get a password token, on a mobile device and put its token into there. It's also very weird, isn't it? So I get my SMS, so I check, it should be here, yes, this is my transaction. But now I have to go back to the untrusted channel and say, this is my token. Isn't it weird? So the question is when to do it. There's a bank in the Netherlands, and they said, RBAC is dead. RBAC role-based access control. It's dead. Because it's very complicated. It's not so really easy, because we have an identity, LDAP, you know, a hierarchical database, and who's the highest person in the company? The CEO, and then you go down to manager, and then you get the developer, the project leader developer. So when you have to have your own registration, you cannot approve it because role-based access control, you have to have a manager to approve your hour sheets, for example. But then you have to program it. Yes, it has to be, the manager cannot do his own hours, and it has to be manager of your group. Then it gets very cumbersome, because yes, we have this very nice hierarchical database, but then we have to add all this code for, and this has to be true, and this is not to be the case, then this gets cumbersome. But these days we say, attribute-based control. So if you are manager of that department, and the other one is an employee of that department, then it fits. So much more attributes making it the whole. And now a bank says, okay, we want to do this for transactions. So for example, if we two would go out every Friday, and he's available, so I have to pay the bill every Friday, and then he wires me the money with his mobile banking up to me, I get 200 euros because it was a big drink. Then the bank knows the phones are on the same spot. They know each other because they do that every Friday, so the risk of this payment is very low. But then you go to Switzerland and buy a Mercedes. That's very awkward, isn't it? You don't do that on a regular basis. It's much more money. It's a very awkward situation. And then same as for credit cards, actually what they always do is say, well, then we need more authentication. That's very interesting to do. So attribute-based, context-based authentication. It's not two-factor for everything because the user will not do it, but what is the situation? What is the business importance? What is the value? What is the risk? It's a fraud. So when you're in Switzerland buying a Mercedes with your mobile banking, it would be really awkward to do so when your mobile phone is in Bulgaria, isn't it? Stuff like that you can relate. I was in a bank and what I had a very interesting virus in front of. So what it is, you log in, you put a transaction ready, then you say, okay, send those transactions, then you get an SMS back with the total amount of the money and a TAN code, so verification code. And then you have to type this back in. There was a very smart virus, and he said, for your own security, we randomly ask you for a second verification code. And they did so. And then people looked at it, my security, you do it again. But it was a fraud transaction done by the virus. And it was so smart, when you looked in your bank account on your compromised computer, it also removed this fraud transaction and calculated a very nice number, which was actually okay without that. So you would not be able to see it as long as you only use online banking on this compromised computer. It takes us a very long time to hold PR sessions about we only ask your time code once. What do you think? 1 year later, a new manager on the marketing said, you know what we do? We have to increase the trust and security of our customers. We randomly have to ask them for a second time code. Not even a year before, we had spent hundreds of thousands on the PR not to do so, and then the new marketing manager said to do so. And it's very hard to fail like that. Yeah? Other question? Who thinks he writes secure software? Nobody does, it says. There are a lot of them. Who does agile development? Agile, do you do a waterfall, or what do you do? Who writes software? Who is developer? People out of it. There's a lot of automation on it. So you know DevOps system. Tom? Who does DevOps? What do you do? You just sit by yourself, write your code. I remember in the time when I started programming, there was a new thing going on, extreme programming, XP, not Windows XP, extreme programming. Who heard about that? Was it hot? Was it good? Yeah. It was really good, but it was one problem. It was driven by the developers, and there was no connection by the business. So before extreme programming, we were here programming, where were the testers? You know the software testers? Any testers in the room? Functional testers? Functional testers? So, did you program test before 2000?
No.
Oh. Because we were here programming, and then those testers were there, down the corridor. So our code, we deployed and tested. Once we go back, this is broken. But what? Why? But then extreme programming came out and said, hey, testers are humans too, we really need them, it's really an art, and then put them together. Because we had test-driven development, who is doing that? Oh, you really should try it. Because, it does pain in the beginning, it hurts. Because you're a developer, you hear a question, you write it in the code. But when you do test-driven development, you just step back and think, what can I do to prove that the function does what it requires to do? And that's what security bound. That functionality is not doing more than it's required to do. When you do test-driven development, actually your code base will be smaller. And the more code you write, the more mistakes you will make. It's human. You're all humans, are you? It's like when you wrote an essay on school. The more text you have, the more spelling errors you have. So you did less possible. The same for coding. You want a small code base, and test-driven development gives you an approach to first think about what we really need to do minimally to make it sure it works. So your code base is much smaller, and testers can help you because you're already thinking in the solutions, and they're like, no. They help you about defining what the business test managers do. It was really good, but then so extreme programming. Less documentation, no documentation anymore, and coding, and actually, developer testers and we become friends. Still, when we have developed something, where were people from operations? In the basement. They're always in the basement, isn't it? IT crowd. So testers and developers became friends, and then we dropped it to the operations and said, good luck. It's working on my computer. So that's the great thing about DevOps. Because you work together, the testers, developers, and operations, we are all friends. And we have a team responsibility. That doesn't mean that we have to know what an operation is doing, but we have to understand their pain. And actually, we see the page because, like, oh, no, what are you going to do now this time? So we talk to each other. We are one team, it's very important. And there's now a new thing coming out, it's called DevSecOps. What does DevSecOps mean? Bring in security again. But actually, what we want is just to embrace security now, but it should be removed later on. And what DevSecOps helps you is like you have a development pipeline, isn't it? Continuous development, continuous integration. So you write code, and the moment you submit it, it will be scanned, validated, and deployed. That's code, isn't it? So you have the whole pipeline, you build mechanisms, everything validated, unit test is good, and then it's shipped. And then you do underneath an application security pipeline, where you do security maintenance. Because, yeah, when you get a code quality finding on your code, you should know what it means. You are coders, isn't it? You are developers. So when I said, like, hey, guy, this is really not a good thing to do, you understand it. But when it's a security issue, you might not understand it because it's not your job. So that's why there are two parties. One says it should be in the development pipeline. I think it should be outside the development pipeline for now because I don't want to. The thing I want at least is put more work to you. You should do the thing you do best. That's develop code. And go through all the findings for should do the develop the security guy. But then I guess you dashboard and tell you what it is, what the problems are. So you can very early now with the abstract pipeline automate the many security low-hanging fruit as quickly you would find. You have code steady code review. But when you look at steady code, it has to do a lot of predictions in the dynamic behavior of the code. Therefore, you have dynamic scan. For example, OAuth has set proxy. So you have already automated the dynamic application functionality testing, Selenium or whatever framework you use, your browser automation, you can point it through an HTTP proxy, record it, and give it the context. You get findings. And these days, because in the past, the more tools I use, every tool has one report, 10 tools, I have 10 reports. Yeah, it's not a nice work, but now we have automated tools who correlate the different findings of different reports. But we need DevSecOps because the security is part of your team. I see in the past, and I was engaged as a security consultant, they were thinking like, okay, we write the code, and he does security. That doesn't work. It's only one who can do secure coding. That's you. And it's your responsibility to make the code work, and to make sure that it's only doing what it's supposed to do. That's your responsibility. Okay. So no questions? That's it. Thank you.